my view of the current state of journalism in India, and essentially what you're going to hear is an extended advertisement for my new venture, The Wire. So you will forgive blatant publicity that I'm going to indulge in through this lecture. But essentially, The Wire is a product of a year and a half or 2 years of frustration with the state of the media and writing and theorizing about it. And after talking to friends and figuring out what we can do, we decided that, well, even though we have no resources to our name, can't hurt to take risks and try and buck existing trends with a venture that promises to be different. So I'll talk about The Wire at the end, but essentially what I would like to do is to paint you a bird's eye picture of the state of the media in India today, and why I feel, as somebody who has worked within that institution, why I feel it's limited and compromised, and in fact, in many ways, deteriorating further, and what solutions or options we have to correct this. Now, at the surface level, if you were to look purely at statistics, the Indian media would appear to be very healthy and vibrant. If you use the number of TV channels or newspapers or the editions of newspapers in different languages and regions as a metric, then clearly the Indian media is thriving. You have maybe 200 plus television channels in different languages that are focused on 24-hour news. You have perhaps 10 or more business channels, business news channels, 24 hours, if you again add up English, Hindi, and regional languages. You have more than 800 dailies, virtually all of whose circulation continues to rise or is at a very high level. Existing papers are opening new editions, new branches all the time. If you look 20 years ago, a paper like Inadu in Andhra Pradesh would have had perhaps at best a Hyderabad and a Vijayawada edition. Today, Inadu probably has 20 plus editions, maybe more, across both Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Hindi papers that were at one point confined to a few districts or perhaps one state, Rajasthan Patrika in Rajasthan, Dainik Jagran only in Uttar Pradesh, led to some cities, Aaj or Amar Ujala. Today, these guys publish across the Hindi belt, different cities, and their circulation is rising. So, it does seem odd then for me or for any critic to say all is not well in the state of the Indian media if the numbers apparently paint a very different picture. If you take a look behind the numbers and ask yourself, what kind of business model operates in the media, all these TV channels that are opening, all these newspapers that come out, what is the business model on which they base themselves? And is there a connection between that business model and the kind of journalism they practice? Then the picture becomes much more alarming. The fact of the matter is that virtually no television station today that is in the field of news makes a profit or can afford to survive on its own. Possibly Aaj Tak may be one exception, maybe ETV another in some languages. But no English news channel is profitable. Hindi, same, language the same. And when you consider the fact that there's intense competition for a limited amount of advertising, it shouldn't surprise you that many of these TV channels rely on either cross-subsidy. So the news operations would be subsidized by a channel that a TV company owns, which is in the entertainment sphere. Or they rely on sharp editorial practices, unethical editorial practices, in order to generate revenue to supplement what is often an inadequate advertising, what is often inadequate advertising revenue. Newspapers are, of course, more profitable. But the profits tend to be concentrated in the hands of newspapers that have a dominant position in a particular geographical territory. So in Delhi, so typically the bulk of revenue would go to the number one and the number two, the two market leaders in any territory. So in Delhi, only the Times of India and the Hindustan Times make a profit. Every other newspaper loses money on its Delhi office. And the same is true of every other market that you look at. In some cases, in Chennai, for example, where the Hindu is number one, Times of India is number two, but there only the Times of India makes money. Sorry, only the Hindu makes money in Chennai on its Chennai operation. And the Times of India would rely on subsidizing its Madras venture from the profits it makes, say, in Bombay and Delhi or Bangalore. Now, I'm mentioning all of this about the manner in which the industry operates and the kind of profit constraint it faces, because I believe the Achilles heel of the Indian media is the business model and the way in which revenue increasingly depends only on advertising and on collateral businesses. And I will like to elaborate on this a little further. If I were to describe the different elements or the most important elements of the Times of India as a business, or the Hindu, or any paper as a business, how would we, what would the key features of this be? Well, you publish a paper, and sometimes is another example, publish a paper which you sell to readers. But what readers are charged is a fraction of the cost of production. So an average edition of the Times of India or the Hindustan Times of Delhi, which is say about 30 or 35 pages, 36 pages or 40 pages in some cases, which would cost anywhere from 15 to 20 rupees to print, is sold to the reader for about 3 or 3.50. So those of you who know a little bit of economics, and I hope there is some economics teaching here, the marginal revenue from the sale of every copy of the Times of India or the Hindustan Times is negative. Right? Every initial copy that the Times of India or Hindustan Times sells in Delhi loses the company about 15 rupees. And how do you make profit in such a scenario with a negative marginal revenue? You do that by relying on advertising revenue. So if around the world the industry norm is that about 60% of revenue for print, for the print industry, comes from advertising, while 40% comes from subscription or cover price. In India, roughly 90 to 92, 93% comes from advertising, and only 5 to 7% of total revenue comes from cover price. So it's the 90% that is the most important, and which allows the publisher of a newspaper to, in a way, subsidize the cost of the each edition, so that instead of selling the paper at 15 rupees or 20 rupees and thus having a much lower circulation, you can sell it for 2 or 3 and recoup your money and make profit by selling advertising space. Now, in principle, there's nothing wrong with such a model, except that the proportions are all wrong. If such a model, I mean, as I said, throughout the world, this is the fundamental model, that advertising accounts for the lion's share of newspaper revenue. But nowhere is the ratio so skewed in favor of advertising, no mature market, as it is in India. And if you were to plot a time series graph about the ad dependency of the newspaper industry, you would see the graph steadily rising. So in the 50s and 60s, when the Press Commission examined the economics of the newspaper industry, they found that the ad ratio was around 55 to 60%, which is the global norm. Today it's more than 90%, although I don't think there's been an official study, but having worked inside two papers, I can tell you that pretty much is the industry average. So this is one element of the Indian print business model that we need to take into account and set aside for the moment. Excessive dependence on advertising. Very based on the assumption, the fundamental assumption is a very, very low cover price. Now, you could look at the experience of other countries in the subcontinent. In Pakistan, for example, newspapers sell for 10 or 15 rupees, sometimes even more. As a result, circulation is much lower. Even if you grant that Pakistan has a lower population, and perhaps there's less of a market in their big cities for English newspapers compared to, say, Delhi or Bombay. But even then, the circulation of their top-selling English papers is barely a fraction of what Indian papers manage to sell. And clearly, price is a factor. So I think it's good that Indian papers are affordable, and I think that's led to a huge increase in circulation, and it has allowed Indian newspapers to buck the trend, the global trend, which you see around the world of declining print circulation. But this has come at a cost, which is excessive dependency on advertising. That cost may not seem apparent to you as a reader. When I worked in the Times of India, Samir Jain used to insist, and perhaps this was his way of putting journalists in their place, he used to insist as the owner that people buy the Times of India not to read the news, but to read advertising. And Vineet Jain, who was the managing director of the Times of India and a co-owner, actually said this in an interview to New Yorker, that the Times of India is not in the news business, it's in the advertising business. So of course, clearly if the bulk of your revenue is coming from advertising, then you as a proprietor will look at this as an advertising business rather than a news business. And we will see shortly how this kind of perception colors the kind of newspaper that you produce. Now, if you are excessively dependent on advertising, what's the downside to this? Well, the downside is that you, when competition increases, or when the economy doesn't do so well, as it hasn't in the last 4 or 5 years, this leads to a decrease in ad revenue or a decrease in the yield of the revenue yield of the average ad, where earlier, say, Times of India could command 60 or 80 lakhs for a full-page ad. When the economy goes into recession, perhaps they have to discount that and sell it for 30 or 40. So there is a natural tendency, both in the face of increased competition and in the face of depressed market conditions, and often these two go hand in hand, there is a tendency for the ad revenue, for newspapers to find their ad revenue coming under pressure. And how do they respond? When you find that for a given amount of newspaper space, you aren't able to generate as much revenue through advertising as you did in the past, you have two options. Option one is where you charge readers more. But you're afraid, if you charge readers more, then they may stop buying your paper. And if they stop buying your paper, then you may no longer command advertisers may no longer flock to you, and be willing to pay a high premium to advertise in your paper. So even if you gain extra revenue through sales at a higher price, there may be a downside from the form of loss of advertising. I think that's a big fear for newspapers, so they don't increase their price, even when increasing their price might, in a way, keep revenue buoyant. What they do instead is that they see, well, if the amount of money I'm raising from advertising is coming under pressure, can I realize revenue from my non-advertising space, in other words, from the space reserved for news, perhaps I can supplement my advertising revenue by generating revenue from my news column. And this is the origin or genesis of paid news, where newspapers agree to print agree to carry information. Typically, it will be unreliable information or information that is one-sided in exchange for money. And we have seen this phenomenon at election time when politicians have paid newspapers, English, Hindi, different languages, to carry glowing articles about how their candidate is leading in the election and how he's a wonderful servant of the masses and so on and so forth. All of this has been amply documented by the Press Council of India in its report, which was suppressed initially but eventually released by when Markandeya Karju was the Press Council, became the Press Council chairperson. And of course, there's plenty of other evidence. There have been cases filed. There was a case against Ashok Chauhan, which he managed to get dismissed finally. But there is a UP legislator who was convicted of failing to declare accurate election expenditure, because of course, when you spend money on paid news and you don't declare this money as part of your official election return, then your opponents have grounds to file a case against you if they can prove. And in the case of, I think her name was Umlesh Yadav, a UP Samajwadi MLA who was disqualified, the only case to date of paid news being implicated in the disqualification of an MLA, she got caught up. The irony is that paid news, while constituting an offense from the point of view of the Election Commission, because more often than not, a politician who makes use of paid news would be unwilling to declare that expenditure, because then it becomes obvious that you've used unethical means to get elected. Paid news is not an offense as far as the newspaper concerned is. This is an irony, I suppose, at one level. At another, there is no law that compels, there is no law that regulates the Indian Indian media in that way. The press and registration, the Registration of Press and Books Act, the PRB Act, is simply a process, specifies a process of registration and requires a newspaper to identify an editor and publisher who would be responsible for any litigation in the event of defamatory news. But there is no law or rule or regulation that disallows paid news. And perhaps that's in the fitness of things, because once you allow governments to regulate or to file cases claiming that XYZ item is paid news and so on, it's a slippery slope. So maybe it's best that law doesn't enter into this. But certainly readers have a right to know what kind of unethical practices their newspapers are engaging in, and more often than not, paid news is disguised from them. The reality of paid news is disguised from them. For years, city supplements like Delhi Times or Bangalore Times used to carry paid news items. Somebody wanted their party featured on the page 3 circuit, so they would pay for that. Or a restaurant wanted a favorable review, or a movie star with an upcoming movie wanted a plug. And through PR, initially these would be covered as regular news items, but eventually the Times of India figured that, well, if the person getting covered gets some kind of benefit from this, then perhaps they should share a bit of that benefit with the newspaper. And they began to charge for these items. And when it became rampant as a practice, and people began to say, look, this is paid news, and the reader has a right to know, they added a strap line. If you look at the bottom of the masthead in Delhi Times or Bombay Times, it says, this is an advertorial, commercial, promotional feature, whatever. I forget the exact words they use. Which is their way of alerting the reader, although it's too small a typeface, and the language is too vague, for the reader to know that nothing you read in the supplement should be taken seriously, because it's not reliable. It's been paid for. There's a vested interest that has financed the printing of that news item. At least there is disclosure in the supplements, but we don't know the extent to which you have paid news invading the main news pages of newspapers. You can surmise or guess. My former colleague at the Hindu, Sainath, wrote a piece about how a paid feature by Monsanto extolling the virtues of BT cotton was carried as an ad in some editions of the Times of India, but run as a news feature without any disclaimer in another edition of the Times of India. And there are other examples of this kind of blatant, paid news. You have other dodgy arrangements apart from paid news. There's the notion of private treaties, where a company that's, say, launching a new product or has a project or is about to have an IPO will contact the newspaper and say, well, let's do a deal where you give me certain amount of free advertising, which is fine. The paper wants to give advertising for free, well, who's to complain? But they want free advertising, and they will negotiate on the side certain number of favorable stories, certain number of promotional headlines, photographs, so that the product is stocked up. And in exchange, the newspaper or media house would get, if it's a builder, he may promise 2 or 3 flats, or maybe 0.25% of equity, or some deal. And these became known in the industry as private treaties between the media house and the concerned company. And this is, again, a rampant practice as far as the two biggest newspapers are concerned, Times of India and, I believe, in the Sun Times as well. They both engage in private treaties. Both officially deny that private treaties have involved any bartering of news space, and one has to take their word for it. But, as I said, there is anecdotal evidence to suggest that in some instances, editorial departments have come under pressure to write positively, or at any rate to suppress anything negative about companies with which the publishers have private treaties. So you can see very clear links in the case of excessive dependence on advertising, excessive dependence on private treaties, and so on. You can get a fair idea of how this compromises the nature of your editorial coverage. In addition to excessive dependence on advertising, and then, of course, going down the path of paid news and private treaties, there is a third element of the business model in the print industry and even TV, which is that many media houses have secondary or tertiary business interests. And in many ways, those business interests are more important commercially than the actual media venture. And it becomes difficult then to say, are we analyzing a media company or a company that has other interests, and that those interests also include publishing a newspaper? The distinction is important. The Hindustan Times today arguably earns a greater share of its profit from investments it makes through mutual funds and stock and on the stock market than it does from printing and distributing and selling the Hindustan Times. So is the Hindustan Times a media company? Or is it an investment company that also publishes a newspaper? I don't know. Times of India, of course, has gone beyond HT because it has significant cross-holdings in different forms of media. It's a dominant player in television. It's a strong player in radio, although radio doesn't allow news, but eventually it will. It will happen. And of course, is the largest newspaper group in India, with the highest volume of sales across the world for any English language daily. So the Times of India, has so many different business interests, although these tend to be more or less in the media space. To that extent is slightly exceptional. Most Indian media houses that have secondary business interests have those interests in non-media sectors. So Dainik Bhaskar Group, for example, may be involved in power generation. Dainik Jagran may have interest in something else. The southern or different regional language media houses may have a mining interest or a manufacturing interest, or may be involved in contracting or subcontracting, all of which begin to have their effect on the nature of editorial operations. You can well imagine the freedom that a journalist working for, say, a Hindi newspaper that is also in the power sector would have. You can imagine the response that she would get, this reporter would get, if she were to go to an editor and say, I have a great story exposing corruption in the power sector. The editor would hem and haw and say, well, you know, it's good, and I'll look at it tomorrow. And of course, the story may never see the light of day because it would be considered too sensitive for the proprietors of that newspaper. So there is a sense in which the skewed economics of the business model of Indian newspapers and television channels, which is zero dependence on readers, because you're not charging them anything, excessive dependence on advertisers, who pay upwards of 90%, and you can imagine when those advertisers are the government or different governments, central and state, what kind of effect that could have, again, on the editorial decisions that a newspaper takes. I've seen in Hindu, when I was editor of Hindu, for example, that when I took over, the Hindu never used to be, would always regard the government of Tamil Nadu as kind of a holy cow. So the Hindu would traditionally be quite critical of the government of India. But when it came to Tamil Nadu politics and Tamil Nadu government, they would pull their punches. And when I took over as editor, I felt that, well, we should treat Tamil Nadu the same way as we treat anybody else. And within a couple of weeks of running stories that were judged by Jayalalitha, who was CM then, as being judged by her as being hostile or critical of the Tamil Nadu government, I of course attracted a couple of criminal defamation cases, which are still like a sort of Democles hanging over my neck, but also advertising got withdrawn. So Tamil Nadu government advertising, which used to come with the Hindu, one fine day stopped. And messages were sent in no uncertain terms that the reason why this has happened is because you ran XYZ story, you'd be critical. So the fact is that it's then up to the editor to take a call. And depending on the arrangements, like it just so happened that when I was at the Hindu, the editor had total editorial freedom. And so for me, serving the interests of my readers was more important than serving the ego of a chief minister. So we said, well, we carry on reporting the news as we see it. And then you deal with the consequences. But many papers, many TV channels, when they come under that kind of financial pressure, tend to wilt, tend to give in. So excessive dependence on advertising. And there are other examples. For example, for years, the Tata Group, which was upset with Bennett Coleman, refused to put any advertising in Economic Times. The Jindal versus Z spat has led to, again, similar kinds of commercial pressures. Many examples can be given of how advertising influences or affects editorial decisions. I remember a conversation when I worked at the Times of India where guys from the ad department used to say that, can't we have happy news on page one? Because that will encourage the companies that that are selling so-called happy products, a vacation or some luxury watch or something. The last thing that a seller of a purveyor of a luxury watch might want is to have news of starvation deaths on page one, next to the ad for a Movado or a Rolex. So there is a sense, in a non-trivial sense, in which excessive dependence on advertising leaves its imprint on editorial decisions. So my assessment of the state of the Indian media is that whatever growth we've seen so far is the product of a very particular kind of business model, which is coming under strain. And the more it comes under strain, the greater is the pressure it puts on editorial operations. Another element of this is that newspapers and TV channels increasingly are cutting back on news gathering expenses. So you'd much rather spice up the news, not by having a field report or sending somebody to a conflict zone or spending money, because if you want reports or news from the ground, then you have to spend money to send reporters, camera persons, and so on. Rather than do that, many TV channels prefer to, the evening, to just have discussion programs, opinion mongering, editorializing. And this is, again, something that I would link to the business practices of the media industry. So in many ways, at least as per my assessment, many of the negative features of what we see in the press today and on television, which is sensationalism, editorializing, vast areas of news not being covered, or events being covered in a particularly biased manner, all can be traced one way or the other to the peculiar kind of business model which exists in India. So we were very, how much time do you have? So we were very, particular when we were trying to see as, concerned editors, journalists, what we could do. Is it possible to think of media and a media venture that is separate from and independent of existing business models? Another impetus for us was the pretty pathetic state of, so if the factors that I've described for you account for kind of the long-term decline that we've seen over the last 20 years in the nature and quality of Indian media, what we've seen over the last year or so is a particularly sharp downturn as proprietors, editors sit on the fence or are risk averse or are scared because of what they perceive to be the unfriendly attitude of Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his advisors towards the free press. So they look at the fact that the Prime Minister uses phrases like news trader or bazaru to describe media, or you have ministers who refer to journalists as prostitutes. And they say, well, these guys are not, they're pretty hostile. So do we want to alienate this government even more and make them really against us? Or should we play safe and not try to antagonize the government and the powers that be by doing stories or presenting analysis or having discussion and debate that they would take as a sign of enmity? And this timorous, or should we say risk-averse attitude of media barons and proprietors has led to a fairly anodyne, uncritical coverage of what's been happening at the official level over the past year. There are significant areas of government policy and decision-making that are not being covered. In the environmental space, for example, most of the decisions taken by the Environment Ministry diluting important norms for safeguarding the country's environment in the face of mining or manufacturing projects have either been relegated to the inside pages or not been covered at all. Certainly, they haven't been made the subject for the very heated discussions that we see quite often every night on television, invariably on irrelevant topics, or even when they are on topics that reflect badly on the government, they tend to focus on what they call the fringe elements, or one or two ministers, but which insulate the Prime Minister or the BJP President, Amit Shah, from any role in some of these negative developments that we've seen. So there's a tendency to keep off controversial topics and certainly to keep off having any critical debate about the Prime Minister and his own role and the nature of the government he runs. And I'm saying, look, regardless of whatever view you have, you can be pro-Modi, you can be anti-Modi, I don't care. But news is news, events should be reported. If, as in the past 3 or 4 years, television channels have lamented the lack of independence of the CBI, right? You all remember the phrase Justice Lodha used of the caged parrot in reference to the CBI's unwillingness or inability to go after powerful offenders in the Congress UPA time. Well, the CBI remained a mute spectator to a CBI court discharging Amit Shah in a murder case where he was accused not of one but 3 murders of Sorabuddin's wife Kausar B, and Tulsiram Prajapati. It's unheard of in the annals of criminal jurisprudence that a murder accused and a high-profile murder case that's been investigated by the CBI on a mandate given to it by the Supreme Court can be discharged at the pre-trial stage, and the CBI or the prosecuting agency doesn't even bother to file an appeal. So this happens and it goes by without comment. No angry discussions on Times Now about how the CBI is not just a caged parrot, but a parrot that's virtually been killed inside this cage. No discussions on where what's happened to the independence of investigating authorities. When's the last time you heard the word Lokpa in relation to the CBI? Not once perhaps since this government got elected. And there are many examples of how the CBI is being misused, but you don't have discussion on this. So to my mind, what we are seeing over the last year is the coming together of all the worst elements of all the negative tendencies in the Indian media, finding a concentrated expression in this sort of collective decision to go easy, go soft on the government. I'm not saying that media should be adversarial all the time or should focus only on negative things. I think if there are positive initiatives that a government takes, whether it be a foreign policy move towards Nepal or Bangladesh or Mongolia, China, whatever it is, or some scheme of the government, Beti Bachao, whatever it is, one should cover and focus and praise where praise is due. But one has to also be able to shine a critical light at failures. And it's the inability or unwillingness of the media today to do that, which to my mind constitutes not just a threat to journalism, but I dare say it undermines the nature of our public sphere. I think it makes for a much more compromised democracy, undermines the future prospects for change in society. If we're going to become a country that somehow holds back from examining, reporting, discussing, critiquing things that are wrong, things that are going wrong. And you see this reflected not just in the unwillingness of the media, but also there is pressure elsewhere on cultural workers. Filmmakers are never sure whether the movie they make will get a censor certificate, whether they have to cut certain words or songs or titles. Plays get disrupted in different cities of the country because some Shiv Sena or some Hindu Sena takes offense to a particular portrayal. History books get banned or are not being able to get published because some interest group says that the portrayal of some historical hero is not to my liking. This is there's a closing in of the mind, that there's a very negative process underway which we as journalists and as editors wanted to fight against. And that's why we decided to make use of The Wire and to create something new. The choice of internet as the platform is at one level very obvious, because if you have no money, then you have no option but to start something on the internet. One of the benefits of the internet is that there is no entry barrier. You literally need no resources to open and start a website. You of course need resources to pay for PTI subscription or to access photographs legally or to pay for contributions and so on. So we managed to gather a small corpus, but it's a very small and modest corpus. But we advertised ourselves from day one as a venture that stood not just for independent journalism, but also we wanted ourselves to be financially independent. And we said, can we think of a new business model for the media that's not driven by family ownership, which is the case with many, many newspapers, or corporate control, which is the case, say, with TV18 now, or some other newspapers and TV channels, or being excessively dependent on advertising? Can we think of a new compact between the reader and the journalist? We call it a joint venture in the public sphere, where readers or enlightened citizens. Now, all of you do, I'm sure, you may not admit it in a law university, but I'm sure all of you guys have heard the word BitTorrent. And are all avid downloaders, and we know that paywalls don't work. When information is available for free online, even if not always legally, most readers, I would say 99% of readers, will go for that option. So we realized from day one that having a paywall is not an option, particularly in India, where as I've argued, you don't even have a paywall for print. If you pay three rupees for your Times of India, and you sell it for Raddi at the end of the month for 2 rupees, you just pay 1 rupee for a print. I mean, that's no paywall. So there's no paywall for print. So how can there be a paywall for online in India? This won't happen. So our model assumes that readers will never pay. And we don't even want them to pay. But can we appeal to the readers as members of different collectives? So, you know, all of you are concerned citizens. So the reader as a concerned citizen, the reader as somebody who cares about the importance of independent media, the reader who cares about the fact that there should be coverage in a country like India on the state of our hospitals or what's happening in the rural sector. So maybe a small fraction of readers, maybe even 10%, 15% of readers say that, well, if I don't pay for the news, then somebody else will be paying for it. And then you're going to get paid news. And then you have no right to lament about it. You have no right to cry about it. If you're unwilling to pay for what you read, then somebody else will pay for that. And ultimately, the price is borne by you, because you're going to get compromised information. You're going to get information that's useless or that points you in the wrong direction. So we launched the wire on this premise that the reader as a concerned citizen might well be willing to come forward if she sees a high-quality product, sees a website that is committed to serious journalism. Our original intention was to have it driven by reportage, but for that you need reporters and for that you need money, so we will eventually get there. But we've been pretty gratified by the show of support from readers and well-wishers around the country, and are quite confident that our modest start, I hope at least some of you have seen the wire on it so far, we are quite confident of ramping up in the coming weeks and months as money from supporters comes in, and we are able to use that to pay reporters, to send reporters to different parts of the country and the world, because we feel looking at the world from Indian eyes is also important. And if you notice, we have reports from Brazil or from Southeast Asia or the Middle East. That's important. You know, we can't be dependent only on BBC or CNN or Al Jazeera or Reuters or AP. But you need to understand the world from your own perspective. So we're confident of this journey reaching its at least the next stage. And you know, we believe, incidentally, that we're not unique. We're not the only ones. As they say in the Theka Ni Laga Rakha Humne. In the sense that lots of other people who are thinking and working in this direction. My colleague Sainath has the website called PARI, People's Archive for Rural India. It's a wonderful site. I recently was talking to Prem Panikar, who used to be with the Yahoo, who has now started something called PP, which is again a website focusing on rural India, rural reportage. I'm sure you've heard of Scroll, which is a commercial venture, but it's a website that again tries to present news from a perspective that you perhaps don't find elsewhere. There's a website called India Spend, which is perhaps India's strongest data journalism venture up to now. And there are a few other sites that are coming up or people are working on, which are contributing to what I believe is a small but vibrant ecosystem of independent reporting, independent analysis, that in the fitness of time will pose a serious challenge to the lazy, unethical way in which the mainstream media is going about its job. Thank you very much.